Good evening, my name is Colin McAuliffe, I'm your host for the evening. I would like to welcome to the stage the director, Mr. Joe Angio.
Thanks for sticking around. I'm going to stick around. Let's bring some Mekons down here. Kevin and Andy and Mark and Robert and Susie and Sarah. Mark, say Mark?
Yes, he is.
Kevin.
This is quite a unique calibration of Mekons on stage. Kevin, are you the pivot? Are you the pivot of this calibration of Mekons?
I like to think I'm the pivot of anything.
Fantastic. I'll open this out to both the Mekons and to the audience in a few moments. But Joe, a few questions for you initially. What was your initial contact with the Mekons? How did you become a fan first day?
I actually come into as a fan rather late in their career. A colleague at work in around 1991-92 made a tape for me of Rock and Roll and The Curse. I was aware of them because I grew up in Chicago and I'd go to Wax Tracks Records and I would see all these Mekons records in the stacks. But I just a band that slipped through the cracks for me. And so this colleague made this tape for me and I loved him. I loved Rock and Roll, and then was so struck by how, not only how so many of the songs on that album were different from one another, but then how the next record, they were so much different than the previous one. So then I do like any fan does when you learn about a new band, you start going backwards. And then I just, like, whoa, this is, and these are totally different than the ones I've just heard. And then I think within that first year, I saw them live for the first time. I think in Austin, South by Southwest. Maybe it was New York, I forget, I'm hazy on that. And then that just is when it clicked. Because, you know, anytime, you know, anyone who's seen this band live knows what that's like. So that's my introduction to them, but they're already 14 years old at that point. And then when I approached them in 2007, you know, they were now 30 years old. And so it was telling the story that's sort of still continuing, but then telling the historical story going backward.
In terms of approaching the 650 members of Mekons past the presence, did any of them have any qualms with, you know, this outsider coming in to make a film about the band?
It didn't make me feel as such.
Well, that's good.
We certainly knew that you had a handful and it wasn't going to be very easy.
You know, I had, there's two good friends of mine are friends with John and Eric, and I think by extension the band, and that was they were the linchpin, because I think they vouched for me. I wrote to John first because they knew John, and I think he immediately called those guys up and sussed me out, and I showed them my first film, and I think he passed, you know, that film, the Melvin Van Peebles film, got around, and people were like, okay, we're in good hands, we can trust him, because, you know, I had a Mitch, ladies and gentlemen. So yeah, I never felt any real, you know, trepidation by anyone.
That's a good spot.
Hello. I joined the Mekons for a couple of days once.
Lasted a bit longer though.
How did the rest of you feel about this outsider coming in and asking you all these questions and following you on the roads?
Well, everyone's really nice, so I think everyone just got on with it.
I think it was just me. Mm-hmm. I didn't have a crew or anything. I had a small camera, no lights. And you know, the first thing I did with them was that, you know, preparing for the UK tours on the road, and then when they were in the house recording the album that would become Ancient and Modern. And so I just, I went into that thinking it was just going to be like a fact-finding mission, just getting them comfortable with me. But I ended up getting so much good stuff that became obviously like the narrative spine of the film. And I think there's just so many of them that I just kind of got lost in the woodwork. Because it was easy to just blend in and work around and just try to, you know, stay out of their way.
During the filming, was there anything that you missed out on that you wished you'd actually captured? Were there any incidents?
Yeah,
there's
can I, this is also, I've been sort of dreading this moment because I have to make my public mea culpa to Mitch, who didn't make the final cut.
That's because I'm boring. And also, Joe did ask me questions, and I said, what happens on the road, stays on the road. No comment.
Exactly.
You could have given subtitles for the Americans.
Do you guys remember, it was early on after you learned, after that first gig when you went to Sheffield, gig was canceled.
Yes, yeah.
And so the itinerary changed, and we, you know, went off to some at Days Inn that you see, and we arrived at a certain time where there's like the one pub that was still serving food was like closing in 15 minutes, so it was just like, drop off your gear, get back in the van and go to the pub. And so I didn't bring my camera, and at this pub, the whole band sits around and has this impromptu meeting about these cancellations and, you know, and how, you know, what that means. This is the first time this ever happened in the Mekons, and what does it mean to be as a Mekon? We have to keep going. And I'm like, where's like trying to will one into my hand. It was just to me like this, like one of those documentary makers, just like dream moments, where it's just like honesty. And then the next day, I actually asked John and Sally separately, and I said, like, if I was shooting that, would that have been cool? And he goes, if you were shooting that, we wouldn't have had that conversation.
I'm going to open this out to the audience. We have a microphone, so if you have any questions, please wait for the microphone to reach you. Anyone have a question for the assembled Mekons and or for Joe about the documentary? Yes.
Question for Joe. Obviously, you can't condense 30 odd years into a film, but there was one jump from getting dropped by Virgin, basically, to the sort of country and folk thing, and totally misses out that sort of second album period. I just wondered if that was an editorial decision on your part, or if that lot have totally disowned it. whether that was your editorial decision, or they've disowned that and didn't want it.
No, that was an editorial decision just to condense time. I mean, and this is, I was actually going to hoping to mention this. I'll answer this in a roundabout way. Given that I entered the band when I, you know, at the time I did in 91, went back as far as albums and CDs that were available to me in the States, which mostly you couldn't find those first three records. So when I first started interviewing, the interviews with Kevin and Mark and Andy was kind of new to me. Like, I knew that story, you know, from the full country period going forward, but I didn't know that really early stuff. And so when we had an early cut of the film that I think it was running 75, 80 minutes, and we still hadn't left Leeds. Because that stuff was like really fascinating to me, but we just had to start chopping, and so that was just one of those cutting out to streamline and keep the story moving.
Are you at all worried that any of your omissions might cause you to live for all eternity in the cave of the ice giant?
Next question.
Yeah, first of all, I think it's absolutely brilliant, and I congratulate both Joe and the band for being really authentic. But you've just made me really interested to know, is there a longer version of this to be done? Is there another version? There must be more material.
Don't make me.
It's TV, Joe. There's long form.
Mark and I was emailing about that. I said, there's the miniseries version. Yeah. I just don't know if the world is ready for it yet. and you said we should be a, who was the...
Michael Snow.
Michael Snow. Right.
We used to be very fond of avant-garde films that went on forever. 24 hours, I think, was in
there. I could put it online if you're interested.
Yes. Do we have another question up there in the top right?
Yeah, I really enjoyed the film. I just want to know, in your documentary style, do you always do your interviews sitting down, or do you do any standing up?
John was standing. I will say, what was your question again? That's the first time I've been asked that question. I think generally sitting, but mostly so the subject is at ease and comfortable, is my hunch. I think the ones where we've stood have just been more out of necessity, but I like to sit in general.
Stuart Kerr.
There's a question in the very, very front here. We need a microphone, please. You can stand with this one if you want to.
Thank you. That's a bit weird, this. It's a bit like when you get that, you do that mobile phone thing and you can hear echo of your own voice. Firstly, I thought the film was just great, and there was something of the very best of the human spirit that I thought came across very powerfully. And looking around the auditorium, I can see quite a lot of grey hair. And there was certainly some very slow pissing going on in the men's toilets. And the question I wanted to ask was this, the spirit that came across in the film, in this, and bearing in mind the grey hair, I think this is probably more aimed at the band, but do you think that spirit still exists anywhere? And if so, where? Because I'm not sure it's... Maybe I'm too old, but I don't kind of see it in this monetarized world, like in terms of what younger people are doing today.
Who wants to go first?
I don't know if anyone saw what happened at the Ritzy Cinema in Brixton when Thatcher died. That was young people doing that. They're doing their underground things, they're doing their own stuff. Not exactly what we did, but they're politicised, the spirit is still around.
You wait 30 years for a Mekon's documentary and then two come along. And last week in Leeds, I was at the premiere of the other one, the baby one. And we did this thing, but we opened it a little bit broader into talking about what was going on now in Leeds in the DIY scene, and it's incredibly healthy, and it's very strange because it feels like back to when Mark and Andy and I and the others got going in the late 70s. So yes, it's definitely there. It's there stronger than it's been for decades. I can't speak for London, but I can't imagine it's not the same here. And I heartily recommend you get out there and rummage around. I mean, there's some obvious ones like Fat White Family that we probably all know about, but there's a very strong, self-starting, stubborn as hell indie scene going on now that's just as good as it was back then.
Anybody else in the band want to say?
Yeah, I'd agree with Kevin. I think there is young people still making music and still making the same mistakes. There are still young bands doing, you know, what Kevin said in the film, getting signed by major record labels, then getting dumped and learning the mistakes. But there's tons of stuff around, new exciting music around, just possibly even more than there was when we were doing it, because the means of production are more accessible and anyone can do it. Like Luke was talking about in the film, working in the Balkans, yeah, you know, working with people there you know, you don't need that much equipment to make good records these days. So yeah, tons of it out there. Listen, all available.
There's a man, very eager man in the.
What I think was interesting and slightly didn't really come up was how much the early punk stuff, and particularly the gigs, depended on an underground that already existed. You know, the old hippie stuff that was still there. All sorts of bits of underground were still going, and we used it and were part of it in lots of ways. We used to play with Gong. You remember someone like those sort of bands, Here and Now Band, that was it. And there was this circuit and this way of working, which really punk just carried on with in many ways, and that's gone. And what's interesting is how it's being rebuilt.
John, it's being rebuilt. Peel was part of that. What you're talking about, Peel started with the Magic Garden or something.
Yeah, Perfume
Garden. And he played all that prog rock and Pink Floyd and Soft Machine and all that kind of thing, and then moved on.
But the structures were there for people to use. There was an underground that we used and is now gone, but it's being rebuilt, and it's being rebuilt differently through the net.
I mean, the film was fantastic, by the way. Congratulations to all. I'm really interested in the way in which the Mekons project ebbs and flows between art on the one hand and music on the other, and how at some points maybe it even sits in between them when it's called simply a project. And I was struck, Mark, by what you said. You left the Mekons when, I didn't know if you said it became more about the music, or you felt like the Mekons were becoming more proficient as musicians. Was that because it was becoming less an art project or less an project for you? I just wondered if you could say a little bit about that kind of ebb and flow of the project.
It was definitely ebb and flow. I don't think one ever leaves. You were just let out for a while.
You can never leave.
But it was more, they were going this way, and I still paint and do all that sort of thing. I mean, all of us, every he was involved in art in some way or another. They were sort of going in this direction, and I was drifting gently in another, really. And I feel faintly guilty about having been in the beginning condemned these people to this life.
I mean, because other people have come back, like Kevin, and I wanted to hear a little bit more about Kevin's return.
Return, I'm not really sure about that. I think, as Sarah says, you, and as Sandy famously has said, you only get out of the Mekons in a box. So some of us have spent more decades trying to leave the Mekons than we have in. So I think it ebbs and flows far more than even we really understand. And that's the thing, it's the second or third time I've seen this film, and that's the thing that really struck me, is what a lovely thing it is that it's been in so many different forms, but as John said at one point, there's definitely something that's common through it, even though if you took one little slice out and put it next to another slice 20 years later, you'd go, what's that about? But somehow, whether it's people changing or the focus changing or the activities changing, there's something that stays the same through it. And I think that's, I really enjoyed reflecting on that.
John actually told me a story on this, to the same point, about Dick Taylor. After I'd done the interview with him, and then I followed up with him, because, you know, for doing the titles and the graphics, I wanted to know like what years he was in the band. And apparently he called or texted John and said, this American filmmaker wanted, you know, ask me what year I left the Mekons, and I don't think I have.
And there's a gentleman dead center.
Just a quick question. As a filmmaker, did you have a vision when you started, or did you develop a vision as you went along?
Double vision. Yeah, I did. You know, it's kind of a My editor, Jane Rizzo, is fantastic, and I think she really she made what's a tricky structure look very simple, because there's sort of like three separate things going on. There's this story of my time with the band from 2008 on. There's the historical story of, you know, telling them from day one all the way through, and then there's, you know, peeling off with Susie and Lou and John and Eric and individuals, while all through that weaving in outsiders to give context to all those parts. And this came together really, really quickly. It's like I sent this email to John in the fall, around this time of 2007, met them in Chicago over Christmas that year. John and Sally, and that's when they told me that they already agreed to do it, and it had to be unanimous, and Ollie had said yes, and he said, we're actually, in two months, we're going to England to do this thing. So I just dove right in, you know, in one fell swoop, violating the three vows I made three times never to do again, which is to start shooting before I have the money, shoot it myself, and never, ever, ever put another dime of my own money into a film. But I gotta shoot this. And so it was about a year into it when I finally just started, took a step back and started now trying to raise money for it. You know, get some grants and things like that. So you do that thing where you have this film where you think you know what it is, but for a grant you have to write what your vision of the film is. And cut to 3 years later, as we're starting to edit the film now, when we've now edited the film and we're submitting to film festivals, and you've got to do that process all over. What's the synopsis? What's the short synopsis? What's the long synopsis? And I was really struck by how much it adhered to that early, you know, that early vision, that plan that we had, that was still, like I said, had this structure that went all over it, that Jane kind of made it, infused it together, but it was very true to what I had written, like in 2009, how I envisioned this thing moving. So, yes.
We just have time for one more question, and I think, again, that very enthusiastic man in the center will get the honor.
I'd like to ask about punk. I think, and the drift towards reviving radical folk traditions, which was kind of reflected a little later by Chumbawamba and the Dutch band The X, who started doing folk tunes slightly differently. And I kind of think, how quickly do you think punk was redundant? Because for me, it was redundant by the time of the Anarchy Tour.
No. Depends, Richard, what you mean by punk, really.
Were the Mekons a punk band, Mark?
Oh. Attitudinally.
Well, there's a difference between the attitude then and how cliched it became.
Very, very quickly. I mean, you're right, by the time the Anarchy Tour turned up, the basic musical form was changing already, which is why the Clash were interesting, because they'd already changed it. And the Pistols were just like a sort of joke. But what the Clash were doing was interesting, because musically they were finding other roots. They were finding rock and roll and things. But in that same way, going back to trying where the music came from, people were already looking around, trying to find new things. Like Bob Lyon said, pop was a big influence. Rock and roll. I mean, we were very interested in musical and all the musical traditions. And a lot of that went into the stage, like, partly because people were endlessly tuning up, so we had to do something.
Mark, can you tell, you told a great story that I couldn't find a way to include in the film. It was about your daughter's school.
Oh, yeah.
Which was to this point of what's punk.
Well, it's the way in which the past is repeated back to us, if the past is another country, they do things differently there. The translation from the past is very different. My daughter was at school in Hackney. She had a new teacher, very enthusiastic young man, wanted to do a project. We're going to do the 70s. daughter comes back and says, you know something about this stuff. So I sat down with her proud father. We did lots about punk. She took it into school and showed it to a teacher. And he said, no, that's wrong. You got it wrong.
Your memory is 100%.
My memory is like that. That way in which the past is, and his point was exactly yours, that punk was, you know, this three chord thrash, it was right wing, it was all these other things that it became. Which is your point.
It might ended when the art students stopped doing it.
It might be worth mentioning a conversation that Joe and I had when we were talking about the English dancing master and the and Bill Leader's recording. I showed Joe a book of 17th century dance tunes at Tom Playfair's dancing master. And there is a piece in there called A Punk's Delight. So it's an Elizabethan idea, basically.
I think that would be a good way to finish the next.